Hello and welcome to the Introduction to Databases lecture for CIS 3107, Database Modeling. We will be covering sections 1.1 through 1.3 of our text in this first presentation. Organizations use data to keep track of their day-to-day operations. Such data is used to generate information, which in turn is the basis for good decisions. Data is likely to be managed most efficiently when it is stored in a database. Thus, databases are involved in almost all facets and activities of our daily lives, from school to work, to medical care, government, and nonprofit organizations. In this presentation, we will explore the differences between data and information, learn what a database is, what it does, and why it yields better results than other data management methods. Finally, we will learn about various types of databases. So why do we need databases? In today's world, data is ubiquitous and pervasive. From birth to death, we generate and consume data. The trail of data starts with the birth certificate and continues all the way to a death certificate and beyond. In between, each individual produces and consumes enormous amounts of data. As you will see in this course, databases are the best way to store and manage data. Databases make data persistent and shareable in a secure way. As you look at Figure 1.1 from our text, can you identify some of the data generated by your own daily activities? To understand what drives database design, you must understand the difference between data and information. Data are raw facts, while information is processed data to reveal the meaning behind the facts. Therefore, data constitutes the building blocks of information. Information is produced by processing raw data in order to reveal the meaning of the data. Good, relevant, and timely information is the key to good decision-making, which is fundamental to organizational survival in a global environment. A database is a computer structure for storing data in a shared, integrated fashion so that the data can be transformed into information as needed. While end-user data are merely raw facts of interest to an end-user, metadata is data about data. That is, metadata define the data characteristics such as the type of data and the relationships that link that data. Relationships are an important component of database design. What makes relationships especially interesting is that they are often defined by their environment. A database management system, or DBMS, is a collection of programs that manages the database structure and controls access to the stored data in the database. What is the role of a DBMS? A database management system serves as the intermediary between the user and the database. The DBMS receives all application requests and translates them into the complex operations required to fulfill those requests. The DBMS hides much of the database's internal complexity from the application programs and users. The application program might be written by a programmer using a programming language such as COBOL, Visual Basic, or C++, or it might be created through the DBMS utility program. Having a DBMS between the end user's application and the database offers some important advantages. First, the DBMS enables the data in the database to be shared among multiple applications or users. Second, the DBMS integrates the many different users' views of the data into a single, all-encompassing data repository. Because data are the crucial raw material from which information is derived, you must have a good way of managing such data. As you will discover in our course, the DBMS helps make data management more efficient and effective. In particular, a DBMS provides advantages in terms of better data integration. Wider access to well-managed data promotes an integrated view of the organization's operations and a clearer view of the big picture. It becomes much easier to see how actions in one segment of the company affect other segments. DBMS also minimizes data inconsistency that exists when different versions of the same data appear in different places. And the final advantage is increased end-user productivity. The availability of data, combined with the tools that transform data into usable information, empowers end-users to make quick, informed decisions that make the difference between success and failure in the global economy. Other advantages are improved data sharing. The DBMS helps create an environment in which end users have better access to more and better managed data. Such access makes it possible for end users to respond quickly to the changes in their environment. The DBMS also create data security precautions that restrict access to the shared data. The DBMS makes it possible to produce quick answers to ad hoc queries. The better managed data and improved data access make it possible to generate improvements to the data quality, where the accuracy, validity, and timeliness of the information allows for a better decision-making. The advantages of using DBMS are not limited to the few just listed. In fact, you will discover many more advantages as you learn more about the technical details of databases and their proper design. A DBMS can be used to build many different types of databases. Each database stores a particular collection of data and is used for a specific purpose. Over the years, as technology and innovation uses of databases have evolved, different methods have been used to classify databases. The number of users determines whether the database is classified as a single user or a multi-user. Single user database supports only one user at a time, while a desktop database runs on a personal computer. Multi-user databases support multiple users at the same time, typically from a central server, and are further categorized as either work group databases, which support a small number of users or a specific department, or enterprise database, which supports many users across many departments. Location might also be used to classify the database. For example, a database that supports data located at a single site is called a centralized database, while a distributed database is decentralized and distributed across different sites. Both centralized and distributed databases require a well-defined infrastructure, hardware, operating systems, network technologies, etc., to implement and operate the database. Typically, the infrastructure is owned and maintained by the organization that creates and operates the database. But in recent years, the use of cloud database has been growing in popularity. Cloud databases such as Microsoft Azure or Amazon AWS are created and maintained using cloud data services that provide defined performance measures for the database. In some contexts, such as research environments, a popular way of classifying databases is according to the type of data stored in them. Using this criterion, databases are grouped into two categories, general purpose and discipline-specific databases. General purpose databases contain a wide variety of data used in multiple disciplines, while discipline-specific databases contain data focused on specific subject areas. The most popular way of classifying databases today, however, is based on data usage and on the time sensitivity of the information gathered from them. Operational databases, also known as online transaction processing or OLTP database, transactional database, or production database, are designed to support a company's day-to-day operations. In contrast, analytical databases store historical data and business metrics used exclusively for tactical or strategic decisions making and comprising two main components, a data warehouse and an online analytical processing, or OLAP front-end. The data warehouse stores data in a format optimized for the decision support, while the OLAP provides the tools for retrieving, processing, and modeling data from the data warehouse. In recent times, the area of database application has grown in importance and usage to the point that it has evolved into its own discipline. Business intelligence. The term business intelligence, or BI, refers to the capture and process of business data to generate information that support decision making. Databases can also be classified to reflect the degree to which the data is structured. Unstructured data exists in the original state, while structured data results from formatting, while structure is applied based on type of processing to be performed. Actually, most data you encounter is best classified as semi-structured data that is processed to some extent. Unstructured and semi-structured data storage and management needs are being addressed through a new generation of databases known as Extensible Markup Language, or XML, which represents data elements in textual format. In this lecture, we have started an introduction to databases. In the process of discovering the differences between data and information, we have learned that data consists of raw facts. Information is the result of processing data to reveal its meaning. Accurate, relevant, and timely information is the key to good decision-making, and good decision-making is the key to organizational survival in a global environment. We have learned that data is usually stored in a database. To implement a database and manage its contents, you need a database management system. The DBMS serves as the intermediary between the user and the database. The database contains the data you have collected and data about data, known as metadata. Database design defines the database structure. A well-designed database facilitates data management and generates accurate and valuable assets for decision-making. A poorly designed database can lead to poor decision-making, and poor decision-making can lead to the failure of an organization. Finally, we learn how various types of databases can be classified according to the number of users supported, where the data is located, the type of data stored, the intended data usage, and the degree to which the data is structured. Thank you for watching our Unit 1, Part 1 presentation. The diagrams and content of this lecture were derived from your text. For a more detailed discussion of these concepts, you can refer to pages 3 through 10 in your textbook.